Broadcast tonight, two leading figures from the world of classical music. We begin with Kurt Masur, who recently stepped down from his post as music director for the New York Philharmonic.
At the beginning, we got more and more trust to each other. The orchestra trusted me, I trusted the orchestra. We worked together, not only in the musical field, it was a kind of commitment to each other, which is very rare. And therefore, I would say it's the crown of my life, because the result is breathtaking. The result is not what I deserve, but what we deserve together.
And then a discussion with opera star and former director of the Lincoln Center for Performing Arts, Beverly Sills.
I've lived a lot. I've had a lot of worldly experiences. So I don't come as a woman who has suddenly emerged into a spotlight. I have been in the spotlight for the last, certainly, 45 years. I have had the glitz and the glamour. There's very little you can offer me that is a lure to turn my head. I've had it all. I've never taken a job I didn't feel well equipped for. I bring a lot to the table. If you can't deal with that, then don't bring me to your table, because I don't intend to hide any of it. This is what I am.
Kurt Masur and Beverly Sills, next.
No one from these isolated villages in China had ever attended university until the Coca-Cola system funded 1,000 first-generation scholarships for students to fulfill their college dreams, satisfying a thirst for opportunity. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Kurt Masur is here. He is the music director of the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. As conductor of the nation's oldest orchestra, he holds perhaps one of the most important symphonic posts in the world. In July, he will celebrate his 75th birthday at the Lincoln Center Festival. This will mark his final performance in New York. The New York Times has written, quote, "The Philharmonic has played better during Masur's 11 years as music director than it did in the decade before." He's also the principal conductor of the London Philharmonic Orchestra and will also become the music director of the Orchestra Nationale de France next season. I am pleased to have him back at this table. Welcome.
Welcome to you.
You and I came to New York about the same time in 1991.
Yeah, I was astonished to discover that.
Yeah. And so you have described these 10 years at the New York Philharmonic as the crowning point of your career.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me why.
Most people know that I have been before the Gewandhaus Orchestra for 26 years. It was nearby a contract for lifetime, and as the offer came of New York Philharmonic, I was surprised, and then I thought, this makes you young again.
Yeah.
You cannot rest anymore, you should start a new life again. Of course, it was not to be expected how it goes and how it works, and I was a little bit insecure too.
At the beginning.
But I must tell you, I was right, because I knew the orchestra before through some guest appearances. The orchestra knew me because I came quite often with the Gewandhaus over to United mm-hmm. States.
Your orchestra in Germany.
So in Germany, Gewandhaus. And so at least the surprise was only for a short time, because as we collaborated this wonderful way as we have achieved now, at the beginning we got more and more trust to each other. The orchestra trusted me, I trusted the orchestra. We worked together, not only in the musical field, it was a kind of commitment to each other, which is very rare. And therefore I would say it's the crown of my life, because the result is breathtaking. The result is not what I deserve, but what we deserve together.
I hear you saying that what happened within the orchestra, among the players, and the relationship with the conductor was the most important thing that happened, rather than any particular performance that Absolutely. The orchestra gave.
Absolutely. And I think if we look back, how often we had misunderstandings also at the beginning, and how often we had to be open to each other and honest and say, this is no problem, it shouldn't be a problem, because our goals are the same. This makes me very happy if I look back. This connection between the orchestra and myself, and this connection to the audience, is the same way as we thought, as we tried to build up a trust, that the audience trusts us, what we play will have a high quality, and we trusted the audience more and more that they also come if we play a contemporary piece or quite unknown pieces. Mm-hmm. And this result at least makes me happy. I wouldn't say proud. Makes me happy.
Why not proud?
Look, pride is a very strange thing for me, because I want to continue my life, and with pride I may be failing to continue in a way where I would say I had to stop here, but I continue with another orchestra in another city. It will be the same kind of life. It will be the same kind of vision I have in Paris and London.
You set out to accomplish a number of things. Give me a checklist of what you think you accomplished and what you didn't that you planned to do.
Yeah, number one is, of course, that I think we have reached now a kind of openness and interest of the orchestra, that the orchestra is happy about, at first, that they are highly respected in New York, not anymore criticized, they play worse than other orchestras, or they play worse than they could do.
This was some of the criticism during the 80s.
Yeah, absolutely. And the other hand, as I came here, it was also what I wanted to achieve, that the orchestra feels connected to the orchestra, to the New York Philharmonic, because they were fantastic solo players, but I felt they after the concert they went home not caring for each other anymore.
Yeah.
But this kind of feeling responsible, and at the other hand also feeling they have a home, they are at home in their town. This is, I think, we have achieved absolutely clear. The other point was the steadiness, the openness about discussing everything. Every guest conductor, I asked the orchestra, would you like to have him back? Wouldn't you like to have him back? How did it work? And sometimes, you know, you cannot make a choice and say, he's a great conductor, he should make you happy. Not with everybody it works that way. So this kind of connection in the artistic field is very sensitive. And the orchestra knows exactly. I always only wanted to have conductors back where they felt comfortable, where they felt they could play at their best, and that they had the feeling this is a partnership which makes us happy.
Did they vote against some big names that we'd be surprised by?
Oh, yes. Yeah, but look, in my own experience, that's the same. I don't fit every orchestra in the world.
So some orchestra may say, we don't want Kurt Masur back.
Of course, of course.
Without an insult to your musicality.
No, I don't worry about it. And I, if they don't like me, I don't want to go back.
That's really?
Sure, absolutely not.
You fell in love, well, let me stay with the checklist.
Yeah.
Those things you accomplished. You had some remarkable performances. Tell me those that matter the most to you in your tenure here.
Oh, there are a lot, I must say, because I repeat some of them also abroad, and the cooperation with the choruses with Joe Flammerfeld,
right,
was such a high degree of satisfying performances that I would say nearby all of the choral performances we have done was in that direction, would say, I like them most. And it was wonderful.
The what performances?
I like them most, with the chorus.
Oh, the choral performances, right, yeah? Right, right. Which was the new addition to this orchestra, was it?
Yeah, this was, at the beginning I was warned the audience doesn't like choral pieces and so. I didn't care, because then I started, I discovered, of course, there is audience. In New York is audience for everything, at least. You have different people, yeah, that's a different matter. But then as we started to take Johann Sebastian Bach into the Philharmonic again, with nearby each year a new performance again, it made me happy that we got the kind of style where I would say it is besides the orchestral play on the contemporary instruments. It is one of the greatest achievements we had had together. If you listen in this record set to the Matthew Passion with Peter Schreier and with wonderful, wonderful singers, but the orchestra plays just marvelous. And the chorus is wonderful and fresh and young. So you would say that this is a kind of Bach interpretation which is so much alive that everybody understands the spirit of it.
How about the Brahms German Requiem?
Yeah, look at this. I have performed it before. I was music director, first time with the Gewandhaus. Elisabeth Söderström and Theo Adam, and it was a great experience to come to New York to do that piece, because we did the cycle of all Brahms symphonies together with the Requiem. This was my first Brahms experience in New York. It was very satisfying. The Brahms Requiem after the 9/11 was, of course, unforgettable. If you start to conduct a requiem, which in Brahms' case doesn't give you opportunity of sadness, but it just describes how to overcome the fear to die, to describes the beauty of life, and ends with a hope, then you are absolutely clear that this Brahms requiem never has to be sentimental, never is really full of sadness. It is full of love. And I must say, after this horrible happenings of the September 9/11, we got an audience. How can you describe? Everybody who came to that performance must have thought, maybe I get help. Everybody who sang in that performance or played in that performance felt that we have the opportunity to heal wounds. Mm. It has nothing to do with the musical quality of the performance, which was, I believe, very beautiful, because the spirit of the piece went through. For me, it was the most touching experience of any concert in my life.
most touching?
The most touching experience of any concert in my life. Never I will achieve again that an audience is so united in the feeling. An audience is expecting to go the way through music which was meant by Brahms to overcome the fear to die. And as he added the fifth movement, because shortly after his mother died, he let the mother sing, "I said farewell, but I see you again." And this kind of spirit in that piece made everybody feel this is the way to go on in life. And this is, for me, I was so happy because we asked, and Zari Mehta asked the audience before, that we are going away in silence, not applauding, because it didn't fit at that moment at all. And I was so happy how it worked. With an audience what normally, you know, likes to cough very much. The concert. No, it was deeply touching for me, and I really tell you, as my son came to me and said, "Father, I'm happy for you that you have this experience."
So why are you leaving?
It was not my decision. It was the decision of the board. I wouldn't say the whole board, because I think some people didn't like the idea, but as a board it has to decide, you know, then they are going through. For me, it was disappointing because the first question of the board came already 97 to ask me I should retire the year 2000. And I was very astonished. It was in our blooming time that the orchestra played every day better and better and better. And I don't want to describe very much. It was at least a kind of decision which was made by some people who thought maybe better to keep the management, because there were some differences between us, what I explained today. Some of those reasons. And I must tell you, there is, if I look back now to that decision, it was short-sighted, absolutely, from my side. I didn't make the decision. I said, I offered, I would stay also as long as you have a successor, because we wanted to look for young players or middle-aged or something like the new Lenny Bernstein who is coming up in this generation.
You offered to stay and help in the process of finding your own successor.
Absolutely.
In the idea that it would be a younger person who could come early and be there and then grow into the role.
Yeah. Because I think what the orchestra and myself have achieved, it was a kind of spirit which was not everybody's idea as a conductor. So we needed not only a great conductor, we needed some person who continues what we have achieved. And this came for me very, very surprising, and I was acting, I would say, quite aggressive. I said, okay, I don't go, you can fire me. And then it was agreement, because orchestra wanted to stay with me, it was agreement that I leave what I do now, 2002. I hope that the Philharmonic is going the same way as we have started.
The direction you have started.
Direction. Because there is no other way to keep an orchestra satisfied and happy. There's no other way.
You feel like you had not finished your work with the New York Philharmonic. You had plans and dreams and ideas, and it took a time simply to get it up on its feet from where it was.
Of course.
And all of a sudden, the rug is snatched.
No, yeah, I was shocked in 1997 already, as you might know, because I had started in 91. It was only 6 years as the offer came. But then I started as I ever did in my life. As I feel difficulties, I'm stronger. And it was the same way. It made me stronger. It didn't make me soft or just or kind of resignation.
Knowing what you ran into, these differences with management, would you have done anything differently if you knew it would be a problem? Or was it simply oil and water?
It was not oil and water. It was honesty against dishonesty.
Explain.
If the connection is disturbed by people in the middle who give the board another information than the information from the board to myself, then I feel betrayed. And the orchestra felt betrayed, and we can prove that. There are different things where we had this experience and said, we cannot work that way. We have to go, our honesty. Look, if I stay in front of the orchestra and rehearsing any new piece, the orchestra really is ready and must be ready to accept criticism or to say, this is not good enough now. Or could you change a little bit this kind of solo? Or could you change this or that? And we don't, there must not be any problem. Because I didn't want to hurt any person, and the orchestra didn't want to hurt me. But if they tell me, Mr. Mazur, I cannot understand what you are conducting now, that's okay, then I make it more clear. Yes. And the other way around is the same. And this kind of openness we had achieved was very often disturbed by a kind of habit against the orchestra, say, they are well paid, they have to play.
So what are they going to do now with, they've got a new music director, Lauren Mazel.
Yeah. Lauren is very, very famous and very well known in the world.
Yeah. With a reputation for being a perfectionist.
Yeah, of course. Of course. They can achieve that the same way as they achieved it with me, in a different way, of course, with him. But I think this couldn't change a lot.
The music itself, it is sometimes said they wanted you to play more contemporary music, contemporary American composers. To your credit, you were able to get Wynton Marsalis involved when he was reticent, and nobody thought that could be achieved, and more.
Sure.
But you came in at this millennium time.
We had to fulfill 30 different commissioned pieces already. We had to play them.
Because you were committed to do that.
Of course. It was Zubin did it before I ran, because of our celebration of our millennium and of the anniversary. The other point for me was, it was absolutely nonsense, because we played nearby in each concert a contemporary piece. Mm-hmm. Why American nationalistic offers to fulfill the expectation of somebody? I think what we have done was for the audience to learn that what we play has highest quality, we play it with the best quality we can achieve, and we don't want to misuse our audience with some pieces which are just doing. Look, we did the whole work of Aaron Copland in one season. Who did that else? And what we did a lot of new performances. I was even criticized because some of the Millennium were from outside. But they were so great. Composers like Hans von Hensel, like Penderecki, like Gubaidulina. For God's sake, where are we in New York? We are one of the centers of the world. We are not a provincial American orchestra.
We are an international orchestra.
Absolutely.
Are you at peace with this, leaving this orchestra that you poured your heart and your health into?
Mm-hmm. Look, if you are in love, you just want that the partner is happy. And if I know the New York Philharmonic will be happy without me, it will make me happy too. The point to be in New York, it is a home for us, for my wife, for my son. We lived a wonderful time here, fulfilled, happy. And it will, I'm grateful that we have this time to say farewell to someone you love, like the audience and like the life of the city, the incredible life of that city, makes you feel happy that it happened. It doesn't make you sad that it's over. I'm different in that case.
Kurt Masur, what is interesting here is that this is his new biography, which is in German, and I don't speak German or read German.
We'll come out beginning of next year, and we are in touch with Random House. Maybe they do it.
I would hope
they
so.
They did a wonderful booklet about the New York Philharmonic with Mazur.
Thank you, Kurt. Pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank
you very much.
Beverly Sills began her onstage career at the age of 3 when she won the Miss Beautiful Baby contest in Brooklyn. She went on to become an international opera star, a diva, performing on stages around the world. She was at the New York City Opera for 25 years. She retired from performing in 1980 and for 10 years was the general director of the City Opera. In 1994, she became the chair of Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts. She was the first woman and the first artist ever to lead that prestigious New York arts institution. It includes the New York Philharmonic, the Metropolitan Opera, and the New York City Ballet. Currently, the center is in the middle of a much publicized and controversial redevelopment campaign. After 8 years, Beverly Sills has decided to step down. On May 1st, she will officially relinquish her post. I am pleased to have her here, back at this table, for a conversation about Lincoln Center and this rather remarkable career she has led.
First, why are you leaving?
Well, first, I tried to leave 2 years ago.
I know.
Things kept getting in my way.
Like what?
Every time I decided that this was the moment, the first time was when Nat Leventhal was president.
Right.
And he knew that I had chosen that date, and he decided after 17 years that he was going to beat me to it. So he announced his resignation before I could. And then when I yelled at him, and I really yelled at him, he said, so it delays you by 6 months. You'll replace me, and you'll have a new president. 6 months, you're out. Yeah. So I replaced him, and 6 months, the new president resigned. Yeah. And so I was delayed again. And this time, I went on the search committee, involved myself in the choice of the president, pushed it through real hard, fast, and the minute he signed his name on the dotted line, I made the announcement. I figured, I don't believe in staying too long at the fair. I think people should be saying, it's too soon, rather than when is that woman ever going to leave? And so I have, I'm leaving on a high, and I have great enthusiasm for Lincoln Center, and that's the way I wanted to go. I didn't want to go and say, thank God I'm out of this place.
And there's never a perfect time to leave.
No, there never is.
You leave earlier than they want you to leave, or leave earlier than... Bert Giamatti, the great president of Yale, who died early, used to say that no one should lead an institution longer than about 8 years. He said, because at some point, if you stay there long enough, you begin being criticized for the things you were doing rather than the things you want to do.
You're absolutely right, and I would amend that to 6 years. Not eight.
Yeah.
I think 6 years was more than sufficient as far as I was concerned. But, timing is everything.
Right. Now, what's the best moment for you in this past 6 years?
Well, I think there, I had several ideas that came to fruition. I wanted a free night, a family night of mostly Mozart. Put it out under the stars. No charge at all. Bring the children, eat ice cream. Mm-hmm. Never mind that there are street noises. That's all part of this wonderful city of ours. So I raised the money for it. I forced it into the program, got it into Damrosch Park. And I think we had, I don't know, 8 or 10,000 people come, and now it's an annual event. So I'm very proud of that. I'm proud of my participation in the summer festival, because I was really the first constituent when I ran the New York City Opera in the 80s. I ran it for that whole decade of the 80s. I was really the first one who programmed regular performances during the summer, because I felt there were tourists here. The Met was closed, so the New York City Opera didn't have that formidable operatic rival 25 yards across the plaza. We had lines around the plaza, around the fountain, people waiting to buy tickets. So I've always been very enthusiastic about summer fare. Not everybody has a house in the Hamptons. And
or Martha's Vineyard.
Or Martha's Vineyard. There are an awful lot of people who love being in New York in the summer. Yeah. And given prices that are perhaps slightly lower than they are at full season, much more innovative repertoire, as the festival does. Yeah. The mission of the festival is really to give people here in New York programming that they can't normally see here, so that it's a totally different kind of, you know, you're not going to come here and see Bohemian Butterfly.
Your skill set. I mean, you were an artist. Now, you at City Opera, you had an opportunity to demonstrate executive skills, right?
Yes.
You ran the place.
Yes, I did.
Was it hard to go from being a performer to a manager?
No, I found that I really
had a talent for it.
I like giving orders. I also, I'll tell you the most exciting. You asked me what was most exciting.
Yeah.
Not at Lincoln Center as chairman, because that is, it's administrative, it's fundraising, and there is some programming involved, but it's not as creative as the work that occupied me in the earlier days as a singer, and indeed as running an opera company. The most exciting thing to me is when a set designer, would bring a flat drawing of the first act of Traviata and watch it become three-dimensional, watch it come off the paper into this baby model, and then see it loaded in its splendor. Same thing with the costumes, to help swatch the fabric, talk to the designer. I mean, I wore gowns. I knew what was uncomfortable for Traviata and what wasn't. I knew what colors belonged to this woman. So I think they had a boss. I am a positive person in every sense of the word. I'm a positive thinking person because of my mother, but I'm quite strong, and I can be I can be tough if I have to be. And as chairman of Lincoln Center,
you
let me tell you, what decisions. But the in running the City Opera, I really loved it because I watched all the everything become three dimensional. Plus the fact, as a singer, The singers that worked for me knew that I was probably the most sympathetic general director they'll ever work for. I mean, I know that a performance doesn't hang on one bad high C.
Yeah.
If it does, it was a lousy performance anyhow.
It hangs on all these things to come together.
But the day after a young tenor comes in the office, the only thing that's on his mind is that he missed the high C. And it was up to me to tell him that the rest of the performance was fabulous and that
And
there'll be another day.
Would you have, in another world, have liked Joe Volpe's job?
Perhaps.
But you've
not
done
right
that.
Now, no. But I mean, when I, if I had been offered the Met, or I was offered San Francisco at that time, and I took the City Opera because it was, you know, my company. I made my whole career there. The title of a company has very little to do with my desire to work for it, and it was exactly the same way when I was singing. It didn't matter to me that I sang at the City Opera or I sang at La Scala or it was the Met. Backstage, it all looks the same to me anyhow. As a matter of fact, I'd never seen the front of La Scala until I retired from singing. You know, they used to take me from the hotel in the limo to the stage entrance. God forbid there was any air on these vocal cords. You know, I was just wrapped in cotton. So I never knew what theaters looked like. And it really names matter. It's funny, more to your family than to me. I mean, when I retired, I believe Time magazine printed that I was the highest paid opera singer in the world. I probably was, but it didn't matter who paid me, frankly. It was what I got to sing that mattered to me. The City Opera was willing to mount the Three Queens for me. That's, I would have sung it in the tiniest village in New Jersey if they had offered me the Three Queens.
So you were basically saying that what you loved doing as an executive was putting the whole thing together, being part of the process, and what you loved about singing was the process of singing.
Absolutely.
That you loved the doing of the thing. That was the joy.
Yes.
Why has there been so much controversy about Lincoln Center?
Well, I think Lincoln Center is going to be around for a long time.
Don't worry.
You know, it doesn't really upset me. As a matter of fact, some of the things that have been written, I think the people who wrote them would be very upset if they knew how little upset I was.
Really? So you thought they thought it'd get your gander, but they didn't?
No. You know something, I'm innately a cheerful woman. It's very hard to get my gander. I don't have an agenda.
I know you don't, but let me remind you of this. You've written a couple of best-selling books about yourself. And when asked, would you write another one, you said, I don't want to hurt people. Suggesting that if you told the truth now, some people would be hurt.
Suggesting that at this particular time, if I told the truth, it might muddy up the waters about what Lincoln Center needs to accomplish in the next 5 years.
But that suggests if you tell the truth, there's a story here.
There is a story.
Really.
Of course there is.
And what's
Who would
the
think
nature?
There isn't?
Okay, but what's the nature of that story, as I'm asking?
The nature of the story is that these are extremely... let's just take the what they call the paid employees running the 11 constituents, not us chairmen, but the people who really do the, you know, the nitty-gritty work. These are 11 or 12 people who are very territorial, as they should be, very protective of their own entity. And when they get in a room together, and we are supposed to be able to speak openly about what our needs are, how we feel, and it's all to do with this building project. Mm. Has nothing whatever to do with how they function under Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts, Link Inc., we call it. Mm-hmm. Each one of those constituents is autonomous. They all have their own boards. They do their own fundraising, except what the chairman raises from the corporate fund drive, which is divided amongst them as a formula. But they do their own repertoire. They are totally autonomous, so that there is no real problem between the constituents because they're not overlapping onto each other. Mm. In the building project, a great deal, I mean...
It's about turf.
It's about turf.
Okay, let me give you an example that you can use.
Okay.
It's true. It is true, I think. And I know this is true in Washington. In Washington, you have the Army and the Navy and the Air Force, principally the two, and the Marines part. And they all have Chief of the Army, Chief of the Navy, Chief of the Air Force. They're fighting for America. Yet at the same time, when it comes time to acquire planes, they are catfighting with each other about what kinds of tools they will have, what part of the budget they will have, and all of that. You know, different people with the same goal overall, when it gets down to questions of budget and turf, get into terrible internecine warfare.
The difference is that their budget is coming from one big pot.
The federal government. And yours is coming from
11 different pots. There is
11 different meaning?
Each board has their own chairman
right.
You know, I mean, there are the corporations that are on the New York Philharmonic board are the CEOs, the donors. They some of them overlap. There are lots of very wealthy people who can afford to serve on a few boards and do honor to both constituents. I think there is, if they're from time to time, a kind of rubbing between constituents, it's over fundraising. It's not over repertoire. It's not over anything artistic.
Okay. But
maybe Lincoln Center got to a foundation ahead of the New York City Opera. Mm. Lincoln Center is this huge, huge corporation, and along comes the New York, and it happened with me. And along comes the New York City Opera. Somebody got there before them. There's more visibility that is able to be offered to a corporation by the Metropolitan Opera than, let's say, the New York City Opera.
Have you come to any ideas based on your experience that would make things better? A modus operandi.
Well, I think we're there. You know, everything has been, in terms of the redevelopment project, we are 90% solved in all our differences. There is a 10% area, and we are much, much closer all the time, but the papers will never print that. I have said over and over again, we are 90% in total agreement.
Where do you put this in all the achievements you've had in your life?
Well, you know, I don't look...
You can't compare them, is that what you're saying?
No, I can't. I certainly consider my singing career an achievement. That was all on my shoulders. If I gave a bad performance, that was my problem. And if I gave a terrific one, that was my credit.
Yeah.
You know, I'm fond of saying I don't share blame, I don't share credit, and I don't share desserts. But on the other hand, Lincoln Center is not an I proposition.
Yeah.
It is a combination of tremendous talents working
and that is
with you.
And that is what makes it as good as it is, and that is what inevitably leads to the fights it has.
That's what makes it the challenge that it is, because you've got sensationally brilliant people running these organizations on an artistic level, on an administrative level. These are not schlocky people. this is the real stuff, and when you get in a room, you are challenged.
They didn't come there to roll over.
No way. You come into the room and you sit around the table, you're challenged, and you can't come in and sleep your way through a meeting. It doesn't work, which is why on one hand it's extremely stimulating, and on the other hand it is a challenge, and you have to be prepared to have these discussions. The only thing that I object to is the way in which these discussions have been written about. With finger shape. I mean, they've turned some very distinguished, brilliant people into characters in a Gilbert and Sullivan opera. We ain't, let me tell you.
But I'm telling you that if somebody, the reporters or the quality of the people that write for credible publications, whether it's the New York Times or magazines, somebody is telling them that.
I know that. There's nothing we can do about that. We even know
they don't make this stuff up.
Well, they do. They don't make it up, they embroider it. It's kind of like getting a wonderful cake and then adding too much whipped cream and too much junk on it. And in many cases, it loses its credibility. And that has worked in our favor.
I think what happens in stories like this more, that so many stories coming out of the Lincoln Center, but it is that people attribute motives to people. Because you can't read somebody's motive. You don't know what was in their head.
That's true.
And they say did this because. They may not have done that because, you know, and something that looks from one distance, depends on where you look at it, from where you sit, as to how you would characterize something. Someone may say it was passion, other may say it was anger. All of that is part of what brings misunderstanding. You want to be more, what? More, you want to be more, less generous to the press.
No, not at all. I think we're going to need the help of the press to get across to the public exactly what it is we are trying to do with this major building project. That's
because it's so important for the most important cultural institution.
It certainly is, and we're going to need all the help we can get.
Let me ask you this. When you get Beverly Sills, you're getting what? I mean by that, if somebody comes to Beverly Sills, we want you to come and be chairman of Lincoln Center or whatever, or the New York City Opera. What are you getting? You're getting...
Well, you're getting a woman with very high visibility.
Right. And knows everybody.
And knows everybody. There is not a single CEO I can't get on the phone, so that makes me a rather gifted fundraiser. You're getting somebody who has spent the last 50 years of her life in theaters, either on the stage or behind the stage. I have been in the corporate world. I have served on some of the most prestigious corporate boards. A lot of people think I've been a celebrity member. They should talk to the chairman. I have not been. I have served on finance committees. I have been chairman of compensation committees. They don't put decorative ladies in those positions. I have worked for some very tough CEOs, and I was not there because I had good high notes. So I came into the jobs with a very secure knowledge that I understood financial sheets, I understood budgets, I understood bottom lines. And I understood the artistic product. You may not agree with my evaluation of an artistic product, but you can say that I come to that conclusion from a lack of knowledge. That's not so. So when I took over the City Opera, I knew that the New York State Theatre like the palm of my hand. I still do. I have taken some very unpopular stands, but I can be talked out of some of my, you know, very positive theories. But whatever conclusions I come to, I don't come to from an empty bubblehead. That's not where I am. So when you get me, while I giggle a lot and I am very upbeat, you do get a form of prima donna, so there is an area of temperament there. You'll have to deal with it. I think I'm an intelligent woman. You'll have to deal with that also. And I'm also 72 years old, so I have lived. I've lived a lot. I've had a lot of worldly experiences, so I don't come as a woman who has suddenly emerged into a spotlight. I have been in the spotlight for the last certainly 45 years. I have had the glitz and the glamour. There's very little you can offer me that is a lure to turn my head. I've had it all. I've never taken a job I didn't feel well equipped for. I bring a lot to the table. If you can't deal with that, then don't bring me to your table, because I don't intend to hide any of it. This is what I am. I have an ego, certainly. To be a performer, we all have to have egos. Otherwise, what are we doing with these lights on us? There has to be a certain amount of self-confidence. I may not have pleased everybody that ever heard me when I sang, but I was a damn good singer, and it would be very hard to convince me that I wasn't. I ran the City Opera from a very difficult position. I left it in a financially sound and artistically sound position when I left it. I leave Lincoln Center better than when I came into it. It may be in a difficult period at the moment, but when they emerge from this period, some of the positives will be because I was there for 8 years.
And things you've set in motion.
Yes.
To music for a second. Is there one performance for you that, more than any one performance, one evening on an opera stage, that you cherish more than all others?
Yes. It was the opening night of Roberto Devereux when I played Queen Elizabeth. It was the only perfect performance I ever sang in my life, and I was never able to duplicate it.
Why was it perfect?
Everything I set out to do, I did. Every note that I wanted to sing in a particular way to get something across worked. Every gesture I made, it was where it should have been, and I was never able to do it again. It was one of those nights that it didn't, it was just for me. I can remember everything about that performance.
According to Lincoln Center, this rather remarkable night for Beverly Sills was not recorded. But here is a look at a 1975 performance of Roberto Devereux at Wolf Trap in Virginia.
Thank you.
it's interesting, it was the Cleopatra that turned my whole career around. And I remember that opening night. I also remember going with Peter the next, we were living in Boston. And I remember sitting in the back of the car, you know, we went back to Boston and there were the five children sitting there. I knew that something spectacular had happened. The audience screamed and yelled and everything was wonderful. But I expected myself to be able to sing Cleopatra like that. There wasn't a hurdle in that score for me. I mean, I could play my age, the costumes were lovely. The singing, the Handel singing was like medicine for my voice. I expected to sing that performance that way. So when the reaction was that nice, terrific. The Devereux was such a challenge for me. There were, you know, 55 pounds of costume. I was 60 something years old on the stage. And I was, 25 years younger than that at the time I did it. The score was so difficult. I cannot describe to you how difficult it is to sing Queen Elizabeth. There is no score that I've ever attempted that was that much of a challenge. And I thought, you know, I'll do the very best I can. I thought 85-90% if I can get of what I wanted. And
you got 100.
It just poured out of me. I never did it again. God, I was so frustrated with that woman. I could have killed her. But, you know, it was... I remember I took a high, deep pianissimo, and it just lasted and lasted. I don't know where the breath came from. I remember listening to myself and thought, drop it, kid, drop it. You know, don't prolong it any. It just poured out of me. Never could do that again.
When you're in the midst of it, as we close this, if you're in the midst of this, is it like pitching a no-hitter, or like if you're Tiger Woods on the last day of the Masters and you're shooting, you know, it looks like a 63 or a 64. You know how good it is from moment to moment to moment. You just feel that this is something very, very special.
I couldn't wait to get on the stage to start it. That was the first thing. I mean, I wasn't even thinking of my singing. I wasn't thinking of anything. All I could think of was to get on that stage and do this woman. By the time I got to the final mad scene, I was on another planet. I really sort of took on this woman's body. I mean, it was a weird, weird feeling. But what was so incredible to me was that I felt I could do anything with my voice I wanted to. And that just doesn't happen a lot. It never, to me, never happened again.
It worked out just fine. My colleague, Mike Wallace, once introduced Beverly Sills at the beginning of a 60 Minutes piece, and he said, after going through his introduction, let's be frank, he said, I love her, and so do I. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Charlie. I love you, too.
Beverly Sills, thank you for joining us for the hour. We'll see you next time.
Not all startup companies get started on Wall Street. Our local bottlers in South Africa have funded 3,500 small store owners, serving the people far from town, satisfying a thirst for a better future. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next trailer is the filmmakers behind two of the biggest films of the year, Ron Howard with A Beautiful Mind and Peter Jackson with The Lord of the Rings. Join